Hi, everyone. I'm Cédric Teisseyre-Héritier, and I will present you some work I have done working on synthetic-based calibration with pyramid waveform sensors. Here is a really introductory slide presenting how you calibrate an AO system in most AO system existing. You use an external calibration source, you poke on each DM modes or actuators, and you record the corresponding signals, and you get the interaction matrix of the signals of the system that is the image of the inference function in the waveform sensor space. So this is quite easy to do, actually. What I'm working on is something a bit more challenging, is working on the calibration strategy for the future extremely large telescope. And the thing is, to start with, you often have no access to any external calibration source. And you have to consider large number of actuators, deformable mirrors. So the question of how you can measure such a large degrees of freedom system on the future ELTs is quite interesting. And I think something more problematic is that the fact that the deformable mirror is located inside the telescope with a really large distances between the waveform sensor and the deformable mirror. And of course, working with pyramid waveform sensor, you also have to include all the specificities of this type of sensors. And as last point, you also have to minimize the impact on science to optimize the scientific outcome of the telescope. So here is the summary. For classical AO system, your AO system is in a box, nothing is moving, you have a stable environment, so you can measure your interaction matrix, and it should remain stable during the observation. For large adaptive telescope, you will have to deal with a dynamically evolving environment between the deformable mirror and the wavefront sensor. So by that, I mean that you will have to deal with misregistrations that I define as an evolution of the DM actuator grid image as seen by the wavefront sensor. So you have to deal with that kind of effect, or rotation, shift, or anamorphosis. And the problem is that this has quite a bad impact on the AO performance of your system. On the right, I show the wavefront error of a simple AO system as a function of a shift. So you can see that the optimal working point is centered, and that when the system starts shifting, you get a loss of performance, and then the loop can become unstable. So there's a need to monitor and compensate for this misregistration, and typically what we want to do is remain under 10% of a subaperture shift, but this is of course system dependent because it depends on the number of modes that you are controlling. So to do that, what we propose to do is to work on pseudo-synthetic interaction matrices. So the idea is to generate the interaction matrix from a synthetic model of the AO system. So this is not something new. It has been done at the Adaptive Optic Facility, working with Shackartman wavefront sensor. And the idea of this research is to consider the case with a pyramid wavefront sensor. So first, you have to develop a synthetic model of your system. So we are using an end-to-end simulator, or MAO. You model the DM, the wavefront sensor, and the misregistration parameters of the model. Then you have to work, of course, on an algorithm that will provide the misregistration parameters that will feed your model. And to do that, the algorithm I'm working with is inspired from what it's done at the AOF, working on the projection of a given interaction matrix on sensitivity matrices. The sensitive matrices are just the derivative of the interaction matrix around a given misregistration state, and you apply a given small delta misregistration, so it gives you the sensitivity of the system to this misregistration. So this is not the main topic of this talk. I would like to talk more about the type of experimental signals that you need to feed your model, and I consider two different approaches. First, an invasive approach and a non-invasive approach. So for the first one, the idea is quite simple. You want to dither a few well-selected signals on the deformable mirror during the observation to retrieve the misregistration parameters. So the idea behind that is that we don't need a full interaction matrix to estimate a few parameters of the model. And to do this, how we could do is nothing new again. We have already identified a few strategies by the community to do this, some fast push-pull measurements, some spatial and temporal modulation of the signals. And the question of signal-to-noise ratio is really system-dependent. What I want to talk about is more about, I will only consider fast push-pull measurement for the sake of simplicity. But what we want to discuss today is what type of signals do we need, and questioning the special properties of the signal and what will be the impact on the scientific path. So what we want to do is to minimize actually the number of signals required to identify accurately the missed registration parameters. And to do that, we propose to do a principal component analysis of a sensitivity matrix. So the idea is that this sensitivity matrix defines the sensibility of the system to a missed registration. And if you do an eigenvalue decomposition of this matrix, the first eigenmodes will explain the most variance due to the perturbation. So here, in that case, a given missed registration. And this kind of work will provide you these modes. So for instance, the rotation, the shift, X and Y for a really simple system. And these modes are actually quite intuitive. We actually expect this mode to be sensitive to the missed registration we're looking at. So it's quite comforting, I would say. So now the question is, what is this working well when you apply this in simulation? So using the same type of system, we did some simulation. So here, what you see is the estimation of different parameters, so rotation, shift X, and shift Y. And what I do is that for different time sample, I change all of these three parameters, and they will evolve dynamically during the observation. And for each sample time, I will measure 20 fast push-pull measurements of these three modes I presented earlier with an amplitude of 20 nanometers RMS. And what you can see is that with this measurement, for different number of level of noise, you can reach quite good accuracy that is extremely satisfactory for the tracking of the parameters of the model. So this is quite an interesting result. You can really dynamically follow the evolution of the parameters during the observation. But the question is now, what is the impact on the scientific path? So of course, there's a lot of more required to really address this issue. But what we can first start to do is looking at what is the effect of 10 or 20 nanometers RMS dithering on a diffraction-limited PSF. So on the left, you have an H-band diffraction-limited PSF. And what you can see on the top is the application of these modes. So here is the most sensitive mode to the rotation. And you can almost see nothing in the PSF. You can start to see some structures using 20 nanometers RMS. And you have to consider the residual PSF to really see the structure of these modes. Just to give an idea, the maximum values are provided. And you can see that for most of the AO assisted scientific observation, this will be almost invisible for the science. It will be completely lost in the AO error budget. So, of course, this approach has a big advantage. It's quite robust. We could try different observing conditions, and we could see that the tracking was actually really efficient and really accurate. The only drawback is that it might impact the science, and you have to be really able to carefully evaluate this impact, but it's so system-dependent that we didn't do anything on this yet. So we have to think about one application that might be problematic is high-contrast imaging, for instance. And for this, we might actually need some more fancy methods, and that's what I will want to present you now. It's a non-invasive approach. So this work is a lot inspired by what has been done at the Adaptive Optic Facility. They have developed some non-invasive approach, the work of Clémentine Béchet and Johan Kolb. And the idea is to use directly the AO telemetry data to estimate the missed registration parameters of the system. In my case, I consider a system where you estimate first the interaction matrix of the system, and from this noisy interaction matrix of the system, you can retrieve a few missed registration parameters. So how do you get the interaction matrix from the AO telemetry data? Here is the basic AO closed loop equation. So you have the wavefront sensor measurement that is basically the propagation of the residual phase, so defined as the difference between what you apply on the deformable mirror, so this is the DM command, and the turbulence phase. And this is propagated into the wavefront sensor, and the whole measurement is impacted by a source of noise on the right. So what we actually will do in this method is to consider increments of signals, and this has to do with a problem of statistics. We want to have a better independency between the commands and the turbulence phase, and also in terms of linearity to be able to develop the previous equation. And you can see by doing so, we see that the interaction matrix of the system appear here, and that is impacted by a disturbance that I call Z. So, to summarize, we have quite a simple equation. We have two signals of interest that we can know and measure, and these measurements are impacted by a disturbance that we don't know. So, to solve this problem and estimate the interaction matrix of the system, we use a maximum likelihood approach, and to do that, you need to estimate the covariance. So, this is the solution of the problem. You have more details in the different papers that are talking about this, but basically, the idea is to estimate the covariance matrix between the delta slopes and delta command, and the autocovariance matrix between the delta commands. But to get this estimation of the interaction matrix, we made a few hypotheses. And one of them is quite strong, is independency between the delta command and the delta disturbance, and also that the wavefront sensor is perfect, so without any modal gain variation, for instance. So my work was basically to say, okay, so this should work. What are the domain? What is the domain of validity, and what are the limitations of the method? And to do that, we first considered what is the composition of the signals of interest. So with a few hypotheses, we could see that the composition of the delta command is mainly dominated by the noise propagation, the calibration errors, the temporal error, aliasing error, and other terms that we don't know. So what's really counterintuitive with this method is that actually the noise will act as a signal of interest because it will create some signals in the DM that will be seen by the wavefront sensor, and this noise is not correlated to the disturbance, while something that might be more problematic is the temporal error, because this term will be correlated to the turbulence that is impacting the measurement. So what we want to do is define some case of observing conditions that will actually challenge this hypothesis. So in my case, I considered first a frozen flow case with a single layer with a constant wind speed and constant direction, and I will compare it to a boiling situation where you have two layers that are going in opposite direction with the same constant wind speed. And of course, the second thing that we want to do is see what is happening when you have different regime of noise. So if you take a nominal case, or I would say a normal case of operation, you have a frozen flow with a 10 meter per second wind in the x direction. On the left, you have the estimation of a parameter in a high and low flux regime, but this is working with a Shack-Hartmann wavefront sensor, just to be closer to this perfect wavefront sensor with no modal gain variations. And on the right, you have the estimation error. So what we see here is that apparently working in high or low flux regime doesn't change so much the estimation of the parameters. But what's more interesting is that if you consider a wind going in the opposite direction, you see that the blue curve that corresponds to a low flux regime is not changing, but the red curves change a bit. And you see this anti-symmetry between the two residuals. And this seems to explain that the wind has an effect, the wind direction has an effect on the estimation of the parameter in high flux regime. So if we go a bit further and we consider really extreme values of wind speed, for slow wind speed, this doesn't appear to be impacting the estimation of the parameter. But for really high wind speed, so here it's 30 meters per second, you see that the estimation of the parameter in high flux regime seems to be biased by the wind. So, yes, it's only SCAO system with on-axis target. Yeah. And so this is working in a frozen flow case. But if you consider now a boiling type of atmosphere, you see that this bias disappears. So this is really interesting because somehow it means that when you're working in a frozen flow situation, you have a bias on the shift estimation that doesn't exist in a boiling case. And this bias depends on the wind direction, depends on the wind speed, and depends on the regime of noise. So we wanted to understand a bit where this was coming from. And since the problem comes from the temporal error, what we want to look at is maybe what is happening if you change the bandwidth of the system, considering different gain values. And what we noticed is that the bias of the algorithm is extremely correlated to the bandwidth of the system, and you can reach some incredible values in high flux regime, going up to more to 100% of the subaperture. in high flux regime. This impact is much lower when you're working with highly dominated by the noise regime. So basically, what we understand from this is that if you correct better the temporal error, you will be able to minimize the impact of this time and of these spatio-temporal correlations between the signals and the, of interest and the disturbance. So what we did is to consider the same application with the pyramid wavefront sensor. I will not go into detail, but we got the same trends, but just with higher bias in the estimation of the parameters. And what we noticed is that using a optical gain compensation, we managed to decrease a bit the bias of the system, and we can get as almost the same performance as a Shackartman wavefront sensor. So it's the same curve as before for different loop gains, and you can see that model gains allow you to reduce this. So quickly, a summary. We noticed some limitation of the method in a high flux regime and frozen flow, but we have to keep in mind that we consider the worst case of application of the method with a pure frozen flow, constant wind speed and direction, so it's not so realistic, and also quite large wind speeds. So as a conclusion, these are the main key message of this presentation, and I will take any question if you have some.